Computer Architecture Information. Today I want to talk to you a little bit about the philosophy of information, about the concepts of what information is exactly. Let me show you this into a little bit more detail. I will talk for some 10 minutes to give you the concept of what information is. First of all, I want to point out to you, I have here on the, by the way, on the right side, my written lecture notes, which I handed out to the students. And on the left side, I have the book I'm writing on basis of these lecture notes. And you will see, you see that they are more or less the same thing, but not completely. So first, I want to point out once more, I've said this already many times, that a computer does not have any numbers inside or text or whatever. The only thing it has is voltages. Everything that is real, everything that exists, has a number, has a unit in the Système International de Unité. So these are seven units, as you know, from kilograms to seconds, etc. And also derived units, which are combinations of these basic seven units. And all the other things that cannot be described in these seven units, they are all virtual, they are all in your mind. And for instance, a number by itself does not exist. Simply, the number does not exist. The only thing that exists are voltages and currents and charges and whatnot, but not these numbers. If you, for instance, have the bit, which is a 1, the 1 does not exist in the computer. A 1 is simply 5 volts, and in our interpretation, it's our interpretation that we assign a 1, a symbol 1, to this 5 volts. And then we can combine these symbols 1100011, and then we can say it's an integer, etc. So these things, these numbers, they don't exist. This is just a matter that these are in our imagination. But it's funny because the computer behaves as if it is interpreting our bits as if they were bits. That is funny. So the computer is following our logic. If we map our imagination, our logic, it maps the behavior or our thought pattern, it maps it to physical behavior of the computer. That's nice. Now we think that the computer is actually computing anything. Well, it's not computing anything. It is just passing electrons and so on. And where this is most obvious is that you can have, for instance, an 8-bit memory address, and it can store a bit pattern, that is to say, voltages, 5 volts, 0 volts, etc., 8 of them, and they can either represent an either simultaneously, for instance, an unsigned short int, or what we sometimes call a byte, they range from 0 to 255, or a signed short int, a signed short int from minus 128 to plus 127, so that is also 256 possibilities, and all of them, because they are 8 bits, have 256 possibilities, because 2 to the power 8 is 256. Or we can, for instance, store there, or we can interpret it as an ASCII character, a null character, then the character A, B, Z, and AZ, with smaller case, etc., and then all the spaces and exclamation marks. Or we can have maybe a set of 8 flags, that the printer is on, that the paper is empty, the toner is low, etc. Or maybe 2 binary coded digits to used often in things like watches and so on, or actually anything else we can come up with. So first of all, you have to see that what is in the computer is not bits or whatever, it's just voltages, but we interpret it as if it were bits. And actually it seems we can make this logical analysis. It's actually quite funny, and then we can understand how our computer works. And now let me talk to you about how much information is in these bits. Of course, we have here 8-bit memory, but how much information is in this 8-bit? And actually, what is the unit of information? Let me now talk to you about the great people in the past, mostly Shannon, Hartley, and Ginchin, I guess. They have made a complete mathematical analysis and have been able to quantify information. Let me show you how this works. Imagine you have these three sentences. First, it says it rained yesterday in London. Second, it rained yesterday in Rome. And third, it rained yesterday in Riyadh. Now, all these could be questions, or actually they are answers to questions that can be answered with yes or no. For instance, it rained yesterday in London. So, yes, no, that means there are two possibilities. That would mean that you have one bit of information, because it can be zero, can be representing no, and one can be representing yes. So a question here, if it's answered with yes, it rained yesterday in London, yes, so that's a one. So it's one bit of information. But then I say, wait a second, it doesn't seem to me that all these answers here, they have exactly the same information. Because if I tell you it rained yesterday in London, you say, hello, it always rains in London, so where's the information? I knew that before you answered my question. And then wait, it rained in Rome. Well, that is already a little bit more unlikely, so maybe that has more information. And it rained yesterday in Riyadh. As you know, it's in the middle of the desert, so it nearly never rains there. So, wow, that is interesting. That is something new. Really? Did it rain there? While the one in it rained yesterday in London? Ha 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 ha. Yes, like every day. So, let's then, we can now quantify the amount of information. Look at this one. I told you it is unlikely that it rained in Riyadh. So it has something to do with probabilities. And here comes in Shannon, which says that the Shannon amount of information in a message is proportional to the logarithm of the probability of having received that message. So the amount of information is, well, minus, because otherwise you get minus information, the logarithm of P. So, and we don't yet know what logarithm it is, I will talk to you about in a second, but you have the logarithm of the probability that it occurred. So, it rained yesterday in London, the probability, that's close to 100%. Logarithm of 100% is zero. So the information is zero in this first message. It rained yesterday in Rome, well, that is maybe 50% chance, I don't know, it must be something close to that. So we have the logarithm of 1/2. That is some amount of information. While it rained yesterday in Riyadh, that is maybe once in 1,000 days. I don't know, I've never been there, but it could be. So we would have the logarithm of 1,000. That is quite a lot of information. So now we can actually quantify information of a message. But this is not all to it. This is what we call the a posteriori observation. I receive the message and then I can tell you how much information is in there. But what if I'm going to tell you, well, tomorrow I will tell you if it rained in London. How much information are you likely to get? I don't know yet, because I don't know what message it will be yet. It has all got to do with probabilities. But this is an a priori question, meaning that I want to quantify this amount of information beforehand. So what do you do then? This is called the entropy, Shannon entropy. The amount of entropy of a message that you're going to send in the future is proportional to the weighted average of possible amounts of information it can contain, that you can send. So this is called a capital A, H, and this is the weighted average of the small h's that you had here. To give an example, if I flip a coin, I didn't flip it yet. So the probability, I assume that the coin is fair, so the probabilities are 50-50. So then the Shannon entropy is 50% logarithm of 50% plus 50% of logarithm of 50% with the minus sign, don't forget. This is one bit. So now I quantify the amount of information. And to reach there, I used the logarithm base 2. Shannon didn't say about what logarithm to use, but we can use any logarithm we want. And for us, it seems that the logarithm of 2 is very nice, because then we have the one bit of information can exactly fit into one bit of computer memory. So that is very nice. One bit of information, a priori information, the Shannon entropy, I can store the answer of that in one bit of memory. A coin flip can fit into one bit of memory. And by the way, it is also the information after I tell you imagine it was tails, then I can also tell you that the information I gave you is minus logarithm of 0.5, logarithm base 2, and that is also 1 bit. So the, in this case, the Shannon entropy is equal to the amount of information after sending the message. And this is the case when the probabilities of the events that are going to happen, the probability of the messages that you're going to send, if the probabilities are all equal, in that case, the entropy of a message is a logarithm of number of possible messages, and the information in the message is the logarithm of the possible messages that could have been sent. To give you an example, imagine that the coin is not fair and you have 75% probability of heads. Heads has 75% probability and tails has 25% probability. So we put in here, let's put it in this equation here, 0.75 times the logarithm 0.75 minus 0.25 times the logarithm of 0.25. And well, you can do your calculator, put it in the calculator. This has an entropy of 0.81. You get it? So that is less than 1 bit. So if the probabilities are equal, the amount of information in a message is equal to the entropy before sending a message. And if the coin is not fair, if not all messages are equally probable, then the information, the entropy in that message to send is less. And this is one of the reasons how we can compact very often information, messages or whatever, or a bitmap, for instance, a bitmap. A very inefficient way of saving an image. I guess nobody in the world uses bitmap anymore. Before it was very popular because it didn't need any processing. But imagine you have a bitmap where every pixel is represented by RGB with 8-bit, for instance. And now imagine that the image is fully black. That means it has zeros for red, green and blue for all pixels. So the entire file is 0000000000000. And imagine you have 1000 by 1000 image, you have 1 million pixels, every pixel has 1 byte for red, 1 byte of green and 1 byte of blue. So you have 8 million bytes of, you have 3 million bytes of zeros. That is nice. So I think that after the first million of zeros, that you probably somehow have the expectation value that these probabilities here are not completely symmetric and not 50%, 50% for zeros and ones. So then you can guess that you can compact this. So you will, instead of this, you will just say, oh, it's 3 million zeros. And this is the reason why you can very often compact files. By the time you have compacted, and you have compacted it well, the final file will have an equal number of zeros and ones on average. I will not go into detail about this, but I will assume that if you're interested in this, you can go to other lectures. I just wanted here to quantify information. And by finishing this part, let me also tell to you that actually a computer seems to be destroying information. And I have here an image. If you look here on the input of an AND gate, you have 2 bits input, and assuming that they come in with complete random probability, so all probabilities are equal. So the combination 00 has 25% probability, 01 has 25% probability, 10 has 25% probability, and 11 has 25% probability. On the output, however, what do we have? We have 0 with 25% probability, plus 25, plus 25. That is 0 has 75% probability, and 1 has 25% probability. So on the input, we have 2 bits of information. If you look at it, this 25%, if you put it in the Shannon entropy equation, you will get 2 bits. And on the output, we have this 0.81 probability. So that means that an AND gate seems to be destroying 1.19 bits of information per cycle. That is, if then later, of course, we erase the entrance of this gates, then the gate itself is destroying 1.19 bits of information. And look at it like this. You switch on your computer, you take all the data, and you will calculate the temperature for tomorrow. So at the end of your calculation, with all the data that you got from temperatures and from pressures and from winds and sizes and whatnot, at the end you give me one piece of information which will be 23 degrees centigrade, for instance. So you have destroyed a lot of information on the way. On basis of the 23 degrees, I cannot calculate back all the data. On basis of the output of an AND gate, I cannot know what were the inputs. While if I know the inputs, I know what will be the output. So information is lost. Now let me finish this. This is a little bit longer lecture than normal, but I want to finish this mini chapter that I have here. So if you're now going to join bits, we already seen here joining two bits. But if we join four bits, we get what is called a nibble. A nibble has 4 bits, so it has 2 to the power 4 is 16 possibilities. And it also has, if all the possibilities are equally probable, it will have also 4 bits of information stored in there. Not always is this the case. Remember our register in MIPS, register number 0, which always has 0000, 32 zeros, meaning that the amount of information in that register is 0. Because it has 100% probability of being 0 and 0% probability of being 1, therefore the entropy in this is 0 and the message itself is also 0. But 4 bits is a nibble. We can store in there things like a binary coded decimal or something, and if we then start joining 4 bits, 2 of them, we join 2 nibbles. What do we get? We call the classic the byte, and as everybody knows, the byte is the referential unit of information. If you look at how much memory size your computer has, you say, oh, it has 4 gigabyte. It's very strange why the byte is the referential unit of memory size, but okay, that's what it is. As long as everybody agrees to it, let's then say this is the memory size is the number of bytes, not number of bits. And to finish this, I want to ask from you to every time when you use the word byte and abbreviate it, use uppercase and lowercase for when you use the word bit. So if you have gigabyte, it is with a capital B, and if you use the gigabit, then please use lowercase b. Okay, see you in the next lecture.